kind of ties in with the tree of life. And let's go to Matthew chapter 16. And we're going to pick it up at 13 and read 13 from 19. You get there, Brother Rock. Looks like everybody got it. Go ahead.
When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets." He said unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it."
Now, when he told Peter, "Upon this rock I will build my church," he was talking about himself and not Peter. Okay, go ahead, brother, verse 19.
"I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven."
Okay, so he said, he told him, he said, "I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom." And really, you know, a lot of people don't really understand and realize that they have the keys to the kingdom. And I'm not just talking about here in the house of Jacob, but I'm talking about the sons of Jacob also. So they stand up there and they think, you know, that they're supposed to go by, you know, what they pastor or say or whatever, you know. And they have the keys to the kingdom right there in the
book. That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And we're going, I just want to trace this down. Let's go from here. Let's go to Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. We're going to pick it up at verse 46. Verse 46, and we're going to read, skip down to 52, and we're going to read two verses, 46 and 52. Everybody got it, brother? Go ahead.
"And he said, Woe unto you also, ye lawyers, for ye laid men with burdens grievous to be borne, and ye yourselves touch not the burdens with one of your fingers."
Okay, skip down to verse 52.
"Woe unto you, lawyers, but ye have taken away the key of knowledge. Ye entered not in yourselves, and them that were entering in ye hindered."
Okay, now he said, "Woe unto you lawyers, for ye have taken away the key of knowledge. Ye entered not in yourselves, and them that were entering in ye hindered." Okay? But anybody that's standing up in front, like here we have a multitude of teachers, right? Nobody monopolized what the lesson is or what's being taught, but we have a variety of teachers, okay? And I just want to tell you that here at the House of Jacob, we go specifically by what's part of the Word of God, line upon line, precept upon precept. Okay? But I brought my dictionary with me. I want to look up the definition of Lord.
Mr. Webster's New World Dictionary. Lawyer. A person who has been trained in the law, especially one whose profession is advising others in matters of law. Lawyer is the general term for a person trained in the law and authorized to advise or represent others in legal matters. Counselor.
Okay, counselor, okay? Okay, I just wanted to be careful. And from here, I'm going to go to the definition of counsel, because it said counsel, right? You know what it said? Counsel, right? So let's look at it now. We know that a lawyer is a counselor. Now we're going to look up the definition. Counsel. Read the title.
Again, from the same dictionary. counselor. Counselor, advisor, person who counseled, advisor, a legal advisor, as of an embassy or legation, a lawyer, especially one who conducts cases in court, and full counselor at law.
Counselor at law, okay, thank you, brother. Thank you very much. So a lawyer is a counselor, and a counselor is a lawyer. Those of us that stand up here to teach in the house of Jacob, that's what we are. We are counselors and we are lawyers. We study the law, and our profession is to study the law, to know the law, and to pass it on to you through the teachings of the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation, line upon line, precept upon precept, okay? And we're going to go from here. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 11. Proverbs chapter 11. Because we have many teachers, as you know, at the house of Jacob. Proverbs chapter 11, picking up at verse 14. I'm going to read one verse.
Where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety.
So in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. And where no counsel is, the people fall. And that's why a lot of people that's going to Sunday churches, they have no counsel. How can you get counsel from reading a half a verse or a part of a verse? You know what I'm saying? We have whole chapters where you're supposed to go line upon line, precept upon precept. So it says, where no counsel is, the people fall. These people are going to fall. You know what I'm saying? If they don't repent and turn to the true and living God, these people will fall. And that's what the Bible says, you know what I'm saying? Where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. Go from here to, flip ahead to Proverbs 15, chapter 15. Proverbs chapter 15. Because we that stand up here before you in the house of Jacob, we are counselors and lawyers, okay? We are lawyers and counselors of the Most High God. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to teach you line upon line, precept upon precept. You know what I'm saying? Now we're going to go from here, go to Proverbs chapter 15 and read verse 22. One verse, brother, verse 22.
Without counsel, purposes are disappointed, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established.
Okay. Now it says, read that one more time, brother.
Without counsel, purposes are disappointed. But in the multitude of counselors, they are established.
Now, but that's why we have so many different teachers here, because we have a multitude of counselors for teachers. Nobody monopolizes what's being taught. And we go line upon line, precept upon precept. We keep exactly what the Bible says. We don't add nothing to it. We take nothing away from it, okay? Now, let's explore this a little bit. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 9. Because most of us that stand up here and teach, we're striving to be Christ-like or like Christ, okay? I want you to, Isaiah chapter 9, looks like everybody got it, brother. Read verses 6 and 7.
For unto us a child is born.
Okay, this is talking about Jesus. Okay, go ahead.
Unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor.
Wonderful what?
Counselor.
Counselor. Is that what his name? His name is called Wonderful. Right. Counselor. Okay. Okay, go ahead, bro.
The mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. For the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.
Okay, so we see that it says, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, okay? The mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, okay? Now let's go from here to Isaiah chapter 33. Now wait a minute. Let's go from here to Psalms chapter 55. Now before you read, this is Psalms chapter 55. Before we read the verses, I want to take the journey a little bit. It says Psalms 55, and then it has a heading just below the psalm. That who wrote the psalm, okay? I want you to go ahead, brother, and read the heading before the psalm.
Mine says, a psalm of David.
That's what it says?
That's what mine says.
Okay, mine says, to the chief musician of Niganor, Maskil, a psalm of David. Okay, that's what mine says. You okay?
It does.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Now we're going to go from here. Let's go to, because I want to clarify this and make sure everybody understands this. Let's go from here. Let's go to 2 Samuel. Because we see that this is a psalm of David, 2 Samuel chapter 23. Hold your space in Psalm chapter 55 for 2 Samuel chapter 23. Read verses 1 and 2, because we see that this was a psalm of David, as we just looked at Psalms chapter 55. Okay, 2 Samuel chapter 23, read verses 1 and 2. Brother.
Now these be the last words of David. David, the son of Jesse, said, the man who was raised up on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob, and the sweet psalmist of Israel, said, the Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his word was in my tongue.
Read that one more time.
The Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his word was in my tongue.
So actually, it was God speaking through David with Psalms, right?
Amen.
Okay. Now let's go back to Psalm chapter 55. I'm going to read verses 12 to 14. Because Jesus' name, his name is Counselor. Wonderful Counselor.
That's right.
Okay, go ahead. Let's see who he took counsel with. Verse 12 to 14. When we get there, go ahead.
For it was not an enemy that reproached me. Then I could have borne it. Neither was it he that hated me that did magnify himself against me. Then I would have hid myself from him. But it was thou, a man mine equal, my guide, and my acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked into the house of God in company.
So this is Jesus talking about what him as a father did, okay? Before he came to the earth, him and the father, they took sweet counsel together, okay? He said, verse 13, but it was thou, a man, my equal, my guide, and my acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked into the house of God in company. Okay? Now you might say, his equal. Yeah, his equal. Let's go to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Because in Psalms chapter 55, this is Jesus talking about him in the Father. Philippians chapter 2, read verses 5 through 7.
Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God.
So he said a man might equal in some, right?
That's right.
So who was he equal with?
Father.
The Father, right? Okay, go ahead, brother.
But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men.
Okay, so he took on himself the form of a servant made in the likeness of men, okay? Now, there's one more thing before I start the lesson. I just want to look up one more definition. So we see that Jesus is a counselor and him, the Father, to counsel together. You know what I'm saying? So Jesus is a lawyer, okay? Not only God, but he's a lawyer also. Now, what I want to do, and that's what we strive to do, like when we stand up here to teach the word of God, we strive to be Christ-like. Read right here, brother, what's lawgiver?
Lawgiver, a person who draws up, introduces, or enacts a code of laws for a nation or people.
A code of law for a nation or a people. Go ahead.
Lawmaker, legislator.
Read it one more time.
Lawgiver, a person who draws up, introduces, or enacts a code of laws for a nation or people. Lawmaker, legislator.
Okay. Thank you very much. And that was from the Webster's New World Dictionary. Now let's go from here. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 33. So Jesus is a counselor and a lawyer also. Okay? And those of us that stand up here, we are counselors and lawyers as we study the law. Give you the lesson. We call ourselves teachers. Okay? Now, let's go to Isaiah 33 and go pick it up at verse 22. Not only is he a counselor and a lawyer, but read verse 22, but just one verse. And then we're going to start the lesson.
The Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. He will save us.
Okay, so the Lord is our lawgiver or our legislator who gives laws to a nation or a people. Okay, he gave his laws to the children of Israel in the wilderness. You know what I'm saying? And I just wanted to clarify that before I started this lesson because I want everybody to realize he gave us these laws. And really, who has access to the tree of life? We're going to start this out in Psalm 78, verses 1 through 7. Psalms chapter 78, verses 1 through 7, the tree of life. Psalms chapter 78, verses 1 through 7. Get there, Brother Barak.
Give ear, O my people, to my law. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, showing to the generation to come the praises of the Lord, and his strength and his wonderful works that he has done. For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that the generation to come might know them, even the children which should be born, who should arise and declare them to their children, that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments.
Okay, that was an excellent reading. Let's go from here to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13. And then the lesson again is the tree of life. Matthew chapter 13, I'm going to read verses 10 through 16. And then we'll skip down to 34 and read verses 34 and 35. Matthew 13, 10 through 16, and 34 through 35. and bid their brother go away.
And the disciples came and said unto him, Why speakest thou unto them in parables? And he answered and said unto them, Because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. But whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away even that he hath. Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing see not, and hearing they hear not.
Well, we just read when he said, I will speak to them in parables, right? In Psalms chapter 78, right? Go ahead.
Neither do they understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, By hearing ye shall hear, and shall not understand. And seeing ye shall see, and shall not perceive.
You know what? And that's exactly what happens today. When you take somebody this word, and you tell them the truth, line upon line, precept upon precept, they don't hear, they can't perceive it, they can't comprehend it. They're so used to hearing lies. You tell them a lie, they go for it. They understand nothing. But you tell them the word of God, line upon line, precept upon precept, they cannot perceive it, hear it, or understand it. Okay? Go ahead, brother.
15. For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed.
It said their eyes they have closed. Go ahead.
But at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and should understand with their heart, and should be converted, and I should heal them.
So therefore, he said, understand with their eyes, and should be converted, and I shall heal them, right? Okay, let's see what converted is.
16.
Go ahead, 3 verse 16.
But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, but they hear.
Let's go from here to Psalms chapter 19. We'll see what conversion, see what conversion. Psalms chapter 19, and verse 7. You can just read it down, read it from 7 to 14. As you said, he said, in order for them to see, in order for them to hear, they have to be converted, right?
That's right.
Is that what he said? You have to be converted. Is that what he said? Okay. Let's see what converts you. And we know that Jesus is the lawgiver or the legislator, okay, for a nation or the people, or a people, right, which is the children of Israel, okay? Now go ahead. We're going to see what converts you. But he said you have to be converted. But pay attention in this first verse, because not only in this first verse do you know that the law of the Lord is perfect, but you know that you need the law and the testimony. Okay? You get there, brother, go ahead.
The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple.
So you still see you need the law and the testimony. Okay, go ahead.
The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The statutes, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Okay, thank you, brother. Excellent reading. Let's go from here to Luke chapter 8. Pick it up at verse 4. So we see that the law of the Lord is perfect, right?
That's right.
Converting the soul. You have to be converted in order to see, to hear, and to perceive the word of God. Okay? Because if you're not converted, then it's just going to go right over your head. You know, say, listen, that's what's wrong with people. That's what happens to people today. When you go with them with the word of God, it goes right over their head. Because they have to be converted. I'm not saying that. That's what the word of God says. Go to Luke chapter 8. We'll pick it up at verse 4. We're going to read 4 through 21. Brother, when you get there, go to
and when much people were gathered together, were come to him out of every city, he spake a parable. The sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. And some fell upon a rock, and as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And other fell on good ground, and sprang up and bare fruit 100-fold. And when he had said these things, he cried, He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And his disciples asked him, saying, What might this parable be? And he said, Unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand.
Because they're not converted, right? Go ahead.
Now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear, then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. They on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy. And these have no root, for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. And that which fell among thorns are they which, when they have heard, go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it, and bring forth fruit with patience. No man, when he hath lighted a candle, covereth with a vessel, and putteth it under his bed, but setteth on a candlestick, that they which enter in may see the light. For nothing is secret that shall not be made manifest, neither anything hid that shall not be known and come abroad. Take heed therefore how ye hear, for whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken even that which seemeth to have. Then came to him his mother and his brethren, could not come at him for the press. And it was told him by certain which said, Thy mother and thy brethren stand without, desiring to see thee. And he answered and said unto them, My mother and my brethren are these which hear the word of God and do it.
Okay. He said, My mother and my brothers are the ones that hear the word of God and do it, right? Okay? And me and my sister, we was riding home last week from the Sabbath. And she pointed that scripture to me as we was riding in the car. We was talking about family and how we and the word of God and how you all are our family now, you know what I'm saying? And, we still love our sisters and brothers, our aunts and uncles, cousins, nieces and nephews, sons and daughters. But, you know what I'm saying, our family is those that do that like Jesus said. Hear the word of God and keep it. And do it, right? You know what I'm saying? So that's just something to think about. So we have the word of God. I wrote that on the board for a reason. Let's go to John chapter 15. St. John chapter 15. St. John 15, we're going to read verses 1 through 11. You get your brother.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth, and that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you.
Now see, it's the word that cleanses you, right? Okay, go ahead.
Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, he can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. And men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you.
So we back to the word again, right? If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you. The word of God, okay? Back to the word. Go ahead.
Ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue in my love. If ye keep my commandments, You shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full.
We'll stop it right there, brother. Amen. Let's go from here to Ephesians chapter 5. Pick it up at verse 45. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians 5, 25 through 27. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 27. That's what we're going to read, 25 through 27. You get there, brothers and sisters.
Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish.
That it might be holy and without blemish. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Now, this is just my belief. I believe that the man is the head of the house, and the woman is the heart of the house. This is not in the Bible, but this is my belief. And anything that revolves around the heart of the house. Okay? Because in our body, what's the most important part of the body? The heart. Right? The man is the head of the house, the woman is the heart of the house, in my opinion. So therefore, anything pertaining to the house is made by the head and the heart. Until you come together as one, the head and the heart, and you deal with things pertaining to the house. That's just my belief. Okay, so I can understand why it says, husband, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Okay? Let's go from here to Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel 36, we'll pick it up when we read verses 17 through 19. We're going to skip down to 24 and read verses 24 through 28. Ezekiel 36, 17 through 19, and 24 through 28. When you get there, brother.
Son of man, when the house of Israel dwelt in their own land, they defiled it by their own way and by their doings. Their way was before me as the uncleanness of a removed woman. Wherefore I poured my fury upon them for the blood that they had shed upon the land, and for their idols wherewith they had polluted it. And I scattered them among the heathen, and they were dispersed through the countries. According to their way and according to their doings, I judged them.
Did we just read that the Lord is our judge and our lawgiver?
That's right.
Okay, so he judged them. Go ahead.
24. For I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you.
So it was the word of God that cleanses you, right? Okay. So what is this clean water? That clean water. Go ahead, bro.
From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh and will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you shall keep my judgments and do them. And you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. And you shall be my people and I will be your God.
Okay, so if you do these things, you'll be the people of the Most High God, okay? And let's go from here to John chapter 7. Pick it up at verse 37. St. John chapter 7, verse 37. He said he would cleanse you and wash you with the water. Okay, pick it up at St. John 7, verse 37.
In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, If any man thirsts, let him come unto me and drink.
Okay, read that one more time.
In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink.
Okay, so we said 37. Is that 37 for the world?
38. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified.
So we have clean water, now we got living water, okay?
Thank you.
Okay, we got living, got clean, the water that cleanses you, which is the word of God, now we got living water, okay? It said, and it shall flow out of your belly.
Right.
Okay, just want to clarify. Okay, let's go from here to Jeremiah chapter 2. Jeremiah 2, verses 10 through 13. Jeremiah 2, verses 10 through 13. You get there, brother?
For pass over the isles of Chittim and see, and send unto Kedar, and consider diligently, and see if there be such a thing. Have the nation changed their gods, which are yet no gods? But my people have changed their glory to that which does not profit.
How did you change his glory? That glory from that which does not profit, because they started listening to that bad doctrine. They started worshiping idols. Okay, go ahead, brother.
Be astonished, O ye heavens, at this, and be horribly afraid. Be ye very desolate, saith the Lord. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters.
So we found out that God is the fountain of living waters, okay? That's right. God is the fountain of living waters. Go ahead, reach out, pick that at the top again.
Be astonished, O ye heavens, at this, and be horribly afraid, and be ye very desolate, saith the Lord. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and have hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns, that can hold no water.
Okay, stop it right here. Name of the lesson is the tree of life. And we see that God is that living water. Okay? Fountain of living water. You know what I'm saying? That's a living water, a fountain. You sit there and drink all day long. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, a fountain of living water. Okay? This one, clarify that. Let's go over here to, let me see. It's called Revelations, chapter 21. Pick it up at verse 3. Revelations chapter 21, verse 3. We'll read verses 3 through 6. Revelation 21, 3 through 6. You get there, brother William.
And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write. For these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst and the fountain of the water of life freely.
So the water, now we've got this water of life. Okay? Water. okay? And he said he will give it to you freely, right? Is that what he said? Okay, just wanted to clarify that, okay? Because we're trying to figure out what this tree of life is, okay? We're going to find out what this tree of life is, okay? Now we're going to go from here to Isaiah chapter 55 and pick it up at verse 1. Isaiah chapter 55. I'm going to read verses 1 through 3. And get there, buddy.
Ho, everyone that is athirst, that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. He that had no money, come ye buy and eat. Yeah, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfy it not. Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Incline your ear, and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David.
Now we have bread, milk, and wine, okay? We have this bread, this milk, and this wine, but also we have the clean water, the living water, and the water of life. Water of life. Okay? Read that one more time, but pick up at the top.
Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yeah, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness.
Okay, now it says, hearken, right? Hearken diligently unto me. What do you hear? You hear words. What words do you hear? Word of God. Okay. So you hearken or you hear the word of God. Okay. Okay. This one, go ahead, brother.
Incline your ear.
Incline your ear. Go ahead.
Hear, and your soul shall live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David.
Okay, you stop it right there. Let's go from here to St. John chapter 4. St. John chapter 4. I'm going to read verses 7-14. When you get there, brother. Verses 7-14. When you get there, go ahead.
There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. But his disciples were going away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God.
So he said, if thou knewest the gift of God. This is a gift. Okay, go ahead.
And who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water.
Living water. But that living water again. Okay? Okay, go ahead, bro.
The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou this living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life.
Okay, now this water, okay, this living water, right, gives you everlasting life. Okay? Okay, go ahead, brother. You finish that?
I finished.
Okay. So we say, it says in verse 14, "For whosoever drinketh of this water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up everlasting life." So we found out that God is the living water. And then he has water that can give you everlasting life. Now we already inserted what the tree of life is, okay? Okay, now we already know what the word of God is something that you listen to or hear, and it gives life, okay? So we just are, we're gonna just go ahead and follow those in the Bible. Now, let's go, because you know, I just want everybody to realize who has the keys to the kingdom, okay?
Right.
And the keys to the kingdom and the tree of life, okay? And that's why I'm doing this lesson, because I was listening to the lessons that the brothers did before me, and I thought this needed to be taught, okay? Let's go from here to Zechariah chapter 3. Zechariah chapter 3. You need a bigger board. Zechariah chapter 3. Verses 1 through 7. When you get there, Brother Barak, it's like everybody's got it, don't
they? And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. The Lord said unto Satan, The Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem, rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments, and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, Take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, Behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with a change of raiment. And I said, Let them set a fair mitre upon his head. So they set a fair mitre upon his head, and clothed him with garments. And the angel of the Lord stood by, and the angel of the Lord protested unto Joshua, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, If thou wilt walk in my ways, and if thou wilt keep my charge, then thou shalt also judge my house, and shalt also keep my courts, and I will give thee places to walk among these that stand by.
So he told them, he said, I will give you a place to walk among these that stand by. So he was around angels at that time.
Right.
And he was saying, the Lord, the host said, if thou will walk in my ways, and if thou will keep my charge, or instruction, or obey my voice, then shalt thou judge my house, okay? And shalt also keep my courts, and I will give thee a place to walk among these that stand by.
Right.
He was talking about the holy angels. So therefore, in order, angels cannot die.
Right.
So he's telling him, look, I'm going to give you a place to stand. You're going to be standing with these people or these angels, you know what I'm saying? So angels cannot die. If you're going to be able to stand with the angels, that means you're going to be living forever, right?
That's right.
Either you're going to partake of something living water or you're going to find the tree of life, okay?
Right.
And you're going to live forever, right? Okay.
Okay,
just wanted to clarify that. Let's go from here to Matthew chapter 19. Matthew chapter 19. We're going to read verses 16 through 19. Matthew chapter 19, verses 16 through 19.
And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?
Wait a minute, the topic of conversation is eternal life, right? Okay, go ahead.
And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
So we found out that the commandments. Go ahead.
He said unto him, which? Jesus said, thou shalt do no murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
Okay, so we found out that you can keep the commandments, right? And live forever, right? Get eternal life. It's the water that clean. It's the water that clean. The word of God is the water that cleans you. Or you can drink of living water, or you can drink of the water of life. Okay, just want to clarify. Okay, so we gonna find out what this tree of life. I think we kind of get the word tree of life here. We're gonna keep researching. Come on, let's go to Revelation chapter 2. Pick it up at verse 16. Revelation 2, 16. Revelation 2, we'll read verses 16 and 17.
Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it.
Okay. So from here to John, St. John chapter 6. We're going to pick it up at verse 27. We're going to read 27 through 36. And then we're going to be skipping throughout this chapter. St. John 27 through 36. Get there, brother, go ahead.
Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endures unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. Then said they unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God, that ye believe on him whom he hath sent. They said therefore unto him, what sign showest thou then that we may see and believe thee? What dost thou work? Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven, and giveth life unto the world. Then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you, that ye also have seen me, believe not.
Okay, so we see that Jesus is the bread of life, okay? And he said, labor not for the meat that perisheth, but for the meat that, you know what I'm saying, that gives you everlasting life. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, it's just a never-ending story. You know what I'm saying? Like I said, I'm going to have to erase some of this because I'm going to have to erase some more. Got clean water. Water, vitamin, bread, milk, wine. Make some room. Okay. Where you at now, brother?
Into the 36.
Pick it up at 48. Now we're going to read in the same chapter, verses 48 through 53. So he said, he's the bread that came down from heaven. I just erased some of that. Now he said, the manna, he is the manna. Okay, go ahead.
I am the bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die.
So he can eat of this manna and not die, okay? So that means he's going to live forever, right? Go ahead, brother.
I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. The Jews therefore strove amongst themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? And Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you.
Can you stop that at 40?
53.
And I skip down to verse 63.
It is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life.
Now we back to the word of God again. Not only that, but he's saying that the word is spirit. Okay, brother, you read that, right?
Yes.
Now skip down to read verses 67 through 68.
Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? And Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life.
So now you have the word, back to the word of God again, which gives you eternal life, everlasting life, okay? Just wanted to clarify that. Because this tree of life, everybody has access to. Okay? Let's go from here to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis 2. I'm going to read verses 7 through 9. And then we're going to skip down to 15 and read verses 15 through 17. You get there, brother, go ahead.
And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the Lord God planted the garden eastward of the Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed.
Okay, now we're going to go back up. I'm going to take y'all back up to verse 7. Because we read the parable of the sower of the seed, right? He said the seed is the word of God. And he planted that word on all different kinds of ground, right? And look who came from the ground. Verse 7. It said the Lord formed man of the dust of the ground. Dust of the ground. So when he planted that seed, he planted it in all types of people. In all walks of life, or on different types of ground, okay? Because man is that ground that he talked about in the sower of seed, where he talked about, he planted, where he says the seed is the word of God. I just want to clarify that. Pick that back up at 7, brother, start.
The Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. The Lord God planted the garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight, and good for food, the tree of life also, in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
Okay, skip down to 15, read verses 15 through 7.
The Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, but in the day that thou eatest, therefore thou shalt surely die.
Okay, let's stop it right there. So God told him not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but he gave him access to the tree of life, okay? Now let's go to Genesis 3 and read the first verse.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yeah, as God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden.
Okay, skip. Go ahead and read on. Read on, brother. Keep reading.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. But God doth know that in this day ye eat thereof, Then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired, to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
Okay, stop it right there. Stop it right there. So we see that they actually took of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil when they actually had access to the tree of life. That, you know, but that's man. That's man and his father. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, it's amazing. It's amazing. I think about it all the time. You know, the predicaments I've been in where I came with the animals in the past, where I came from, where I'm at today. And I say, you know, only in the Garden of Eden, they got done. You know what I'm saying? I wouldn't be here going through this today. You know what I'm saying? When did you stop at 6?
Yes, 6.
Let's go from here to Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12. Revelation 12, and we'll pick up at verse 7. We'll read 7 through 9. Revelation 12. We'll get there, brother.
And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
Okay, so we see that he deceived the whole world. Okay? The whole world. Not just a couple of people, the whole world. Without, you know, we just got to going from the town when all the nations, the heathens, the ungodly, the nations celebrate Exodus. You know what I'm saying? And I partook of that, you know what I'm saying, somewhat. But I didn't really care for it too much. You know, when I was coming up, every time they wanted to put the tree up, I would always find somewhere to go. But it's just amazing. You know, he deceived the whole world. Okay? Which is Satan, the scandal. I'm saying he is real scandalous. Let's go from here to Ezekiel chapter 28. Ezekiel 28, pick it up at verse 12. We'll tie this on me. Because we don't find out who the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Because we know that God, the words that he speaks, gives life. So God is the tree of life in the Garden of Eden. Okay? Because you had four that was in the Garden of Eden. You had the tree of life, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which represents Satan. You had the tree of life, which represents God. And then you had Eve, Adam and Eve. Okay? Now let's go to Ezekiel 28, pick it up in verse 12. Read 12 through 16.
Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, Thou fillest up the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty.
So we see that he fills up the sum, and is full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Okay, and this is one of the people that was in the Garden of Eden. Go ahead, brother.
Thou hast been in Eve, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardius, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold.
Now check, that's a man. But you know, I hate to say it, women brothers just talking about all those fur coats over there, hanging up over there. Women like bling, okay?
That's right.
Now, when it say, when Satan came to Eve in the garden, what was he made of again, brother? Stop thinking of it, 13.
Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardius, topaz, and diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold.
Oh, wow. Now he approached Eve, right? All this bling, right? You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? She's sitting there looking at his covering. Perfect. He's perfect in beauty. Okay? Okay, now he's coming to Eve, right? Now we just read what happened. It happened to her, you know what I'm saying? And we read that Michael had to kick him out in chapter 12. But it's just amazing. Women like bling. That's why women like bling. You know what I'm saying? And he the king of bling, okay? Go ahead, Rock.
The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou was created.
And it says, the workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes. So not only is he full of bling, but he can pump out some music. He can play a tune. He can some music to cruise to. Okay. It says, the workmanship of thy tabrets and thy pipes were prepared in thee in the day that thou was. So, you know what I'm saying? That's why I say music today. A lot of that music you be listening to, you know who behind? That's right. That's right. Picking up at verse 14, brothers.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou was upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created till iniquity was found in thee.
So he was perfect. God made him perfect. Iniquity was he within himself. Iniquity was found in him. Go ahead.
By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore, I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire.
Okay. Just wanted to clarify that. So you can understand what Eve had to deal with when she was in the Garden of Eden, right? And that's why God had put Satan and his angels under chains of darkness where we can't see them. You know what I'm saying? They can dwell among us, but they can't reveal themselves to us. But the holy angels can. You know what I'm saying? If you study your Bible, you'll find that out. Now let's go back to Genesis. We're going to go back to Genesis. Let's go back to Genesis and check this out. We see that it says what Satan was made of. He was made of precious stone. What was that covering and all that? Let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. Pick it up at verse 1. And carry it down to verse 15. So we can see what Eve was dealing with in the garden. He was made perfect. God made him perfect. Okay, Genesis 3, verses 1 through 15, Brother Barak, can you get there, go ahead.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yeah, as thou said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. For God does know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that thou was naked?
So somebody told you some words. Who told thee that thou was naked? That's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which represents Satan. Okay? Because we just read that he was in the Garden of Eden. And we just read that he had bling everywhere, and he was probably playing a nice tune when he was telling her that, but his pipes and his tap were prepared in him when he was 3'8". You know what I'm saying? So go ahead, brother.
As thou eating of the tree, whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat. And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat.
The man passed the buck. Go ahead.
And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat.
The serpent tricked me, and I did eat. Go ahead.
And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. He shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
Okay. Let's go from here. Let's go from here to Job chapter 1. Because when he got kicked out of heaven, a lot of people read this and think, you know, Satan is some kind of serpent or something that's, you know, slithering around on his stomach. Well, let's go to Job. God has took away some of his power, where he, you know what I'm saying, he's not slithering around on his belly like a serpent. Job chapter 1. Job is an excellent book. It's an excellent book. They say it's the oldest book in the Bible. Pick it up at Job chapter 1. I'm going to read this again. Job chapter 1, verses 6 through 7. 6 and 7, right? Because we just read that God told him, because thou hast done this to the woman, cast you down and you'll slither on your belly and all this stuff. Now let's see what it says right here, because a lot of people think Satan is some kind of serpent or something. And we're going to see what actually happened to him. Go ahead, brother.
Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them.
Now pay attention. Satan is not a son of God. You know what I'm saying? Satan came among the sons of God, or the angels at this time. Go ahead.
Verse 7. And the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan asked the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, from walking up and down in it.
So therefore you see that he's not slithering around on his stomach, you know, in the dust, like, you know, like the word said. But God has made his dominion be the earth, so he eats dust all the time. Whereas his place used to be in heavenly places with the Father. You see what I'm saying? So therefore, that's just like eating dust. As a God, I guess, you know what I'm saying? Because he dwells on the earth continually. Let's go from here to Isaiah chapter 47. We still in the tree of life, man. We just take this other breath. Isaiah chapter 47. Did I say 47?
Yeah, 47.
47. I just want you to know that Satan is not slithering around in his belly. He said that he was walking to and fro on the earth in the book of Job. Okay? Forty-7:1. Give you an idea of what God was saying to Satan when he told him that he's going to be in the dust and going to punish his brother. You get that, brother?
Come down and sit in the dust, O bird and daughter of Babylon. Sit on the ground. There is no throne, O daughter of the Chaldeans, for thou shalt no more be called tender and delicate.
So therefore, what God did to Satan, he took away some of his power and cast him down to the earth. And he's not literally slithering around in his stomach or his belly, like a lot of people think. You know, Satan's a kind of serpent. Or like you see in the movie, he got big horn arms and all this kind of stuff. You see, the Satan is a cherub angel. He's a cherub angel. Okay, a cherub angel, I think, has something like 4 faces and 6 wings, with eyes all over their wings, you know what I'm saying? Because God, he actually got these these cherubs, around this throne. You know what I'm saying? They got six faces. You all looking and wondering where you cannot sneak up on God. Because these are guarding, they guard God, right? Yeah. They got six wings and they got eyes all over their wings. Can't nobody sneak up on God. Try to sneak up on God. Because these cherubs, and you need to read about these cherub angels before. What they look like and how they made, you know what I'm saying? You just cannot, God, he got some mean stuff. He got some real mean stuff. I am actually terrified of God. I am. You know, they could drop a nuclear bomb today and it wouldn't bother me a bit. But stand in front of the judgment, it's the white throne judgment of the true and living God, and they come up short, I'm terrified. Because I don't know if they drop that nuclear bomb, God can call me back. You know what I'm saying? And say, Chris, come stand over here. And I'll unincinerate and come and stand in front of him. You know what I'm saying? But that electric fire, I don't want no parts of that electric fire. You know, because like I'm just 51 years old and I can't even begin to comprehend what forever is like. You know what I'm saying? You know, 51 years is a long time. I can't even begin to comprehend what forever in the electric fire. I'm terrified of God. They say the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. You know what I'm saying? Let's go figure it out. You know what I'm saying? Go figure it out. I'm terrified of God. Let's go from here to Galatians chapter 4. Somebody saw me. I'm talking about fear of God. It's talking about respecting God. It's an odd brother. No, it's talking about total fear. You know what I'm saying? They talk about no respecting God. You go, I love and respect God, but I'm terrified of God. I'm saying I have read the Bible. I know. God said he's gonna be laughing because he's throwing people in the lake of fire. You know what I'm saying? That's why he's gonna be laughing. Galatians, what did I say about Galatians 4:4? I want you to read, read chapter 4, verse 4. Read verse 4.
But when the fullness of time has come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law.
Read verse 5 and read verse 4.
To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons.
Okay, to redeem us that were under the law, that we might receive adoption of sons, okay? Galatians 4:4. We're going now to Romans chapter 16, verse 20. God said that he was an enmity between the man, between Satan and the woman. That we see that God came as a man, made of a woman. You know what I'm saying? And so he was that seed that God was talking about in the garden. He said, "I'm going to put enmity between your seed and his seed." So Jesus is that seed that God was. Actually, Jesus, who was called Jehovah, or God Almighty, was in the garden. Speaking of himself, he would be that seed, you know what I'm saying, that would be an enmity with Satan. But read, clarify that a little bit. Read Romans 16 and verse 20.
And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen.
So he said that he will bruise you shall crush his head, and he shall wound your heel. So therefore, when Jesus went into the grave, I'm saying 3 days, 3 nights, it was just like only his heel being bruised, because he did, his body never did see corruption. His body never decomposed. He was raised again to life, you know what I'm saying, before his body could decompose and went back to the Father, you know what I'm saying? So that's why I said, his seed shall crush your head. Your seed shall crush his head, but his seed shall bruise your heel. And that was talking about Satan bruising the heel of Jesus. So you know, this, we have to do a lot of studying. It says study to show yourself approved unto God, working that need not be ashamed, right, in the body and the word of truth. You know, and I just started restudying again. I had took some time off, because I had read the Bible quite a few times. And I just really started reading again. It's just amazing, the stuff that's revealed to you that you didn't get. And I'm reading it for my ninth time in public instruction. You know, and I'm like, you know, it's just amazing how much you can just absorb and get from the Word of God. And it's our instruction, you know, the human instruction manual. You know what I'm saying? It's just, it guides us, directs us, instructs us. This is it right here. We get a new cell phone, new big screen TV, a new car. They all come with instruction manual. You sit there, you know what I'm saying, before you push your button, you sit there and you read that name, you say, because not push that button, I want to make sure I'm pushing the right button. This is the button for us. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? This is it. You know what I'm saying? You want to get eternal life, you want to get access to that tree of life. You want that manna, that living bread, that spirit. He said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. It all comes back to the word of God, which can give you everlasting life. God said, if you want eternal life, keep the commandments. Okay? You know what I'm saying? It's just amazing. It's a never-ending story. You know what I'm saying? Really, it is. Let's go from here to Revelation chapter 20. And pick it up at verse 7. Revelation 20:7. And we're going to read Revelation 20:7-10. Because he said, he told Eve, he said that his seed, Satan's seed, could bruise the heel of your seed, which is Jesus. But your seed will crush his head. Okay. Go ahead, brother. Pick it up at verse 7, 3, 7, 3, 3, 3, 20. Revelation 20, 7, 3, 3, 3.
When 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations around the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever.
And that's what God told Eve in the garden. He said, thou shalt crush his head. And that's burning in the lake of fire. It's just like having your head crushed. You're never coming up out of that lake of fire. But his seed shall bruise thy heel. So he bruised the heel of Jesus. And Jesus is in the grave for 3 days and 3 nights. So Jesus is going to throw him in the lake of fire forever and ever. That's crushing his head. I just wanted to clarify that. Let's go from here to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. three gods. Read verses 24 through 28. Because Satan is thrown in the lake of fire, the enemy of God, and the enemy that follows Satan. Verse 24, 15, 24 through 28. Let me get to the brother, brother.
Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. But he hath put all things under his feet. But when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is accepted.
Or expected, which is the Father. Go ahead.
Which did put all things under him. When all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all.
Now think about that for a minute, when it says that God may be all
in all.
Okay? We're going to be sons and daughters of the true and living God. We're going to be in the family of God. We're going to be spiritual beings just like God. If we want to go and create our own little heaven or whatever, or stars or universe, we'll be able to do that because God is going to be all and in all. Okay? So therefore, everybody is going to have everlasting life. Okay? Everlasting life. And everybody is going to have access to the true life. Okay? Let's go from here to John chapter 13. St. John chapter 13. St. John chapter 13. Verses 1 and 2, brother, we get there, brother.
Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him.
Okay, now let's go from here to Revelation chapter 12. Pick up the verse 3. So the devil put it in Judas' heart to betray him. Revelations 12. Verses 4 and 5. Get there, brother.
And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born.
And then what happened to Mary when she was about to give birth to Jesus? The devil was after her and destroyed her child. And not only that, but with Satan, the star was his, and his tail drew a third part of the star of heaven. Those were angels that were up in heavenly places. And when Michael cast out Satan the devil, those angels fell with him down into the earth. Okay? So where did you stop at?
Beginning at 5.
Okay, go ahead and pick up at 5.
And she brought forth a man child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And the child was caught up unto God and to his throne.
Okay? Stop it right there. Go from here to Psalms chapter 41. Psalms chapter 41. Because actually, if you really want to know, when Eve sinned in the garden, God took away access to the tree of life. And he kicked them out of the garden. You put cherubims near the garden of the tree of life, right? So nobody could have access to the tree of life. And it had s'more, fiery sword that would turn every which way, you know what I'm saying, to try to enter in. Okay? So Jesus, by him coming and dying on the cross and dying for our sins, he gave us access back to the tree of life through all these things that I've been writing on the board, you know what I'm saying, that's in the bindings of this book right here. So you want to know who got the keys to the kingdom? Who has the key of knowledge? Who has access to the tree of life? Who has access to the manna, the hidden manna, the living bread, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life, for everlasting life, for the commandments, which all comes back to the word of God. Okay? Yeah. We've got a few more scriptures left, but I just wanted to clarify that to you. Where do we go, Brother Sons? What?
41.
Okay, let me do it. Okay, Psalms 41, verses 9 through 13. We get there. Psalms 41, 9 through 13. We get there, Brother.
Yeah, my own familiar friend, in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread, and lifted up his heel against
him. Now, didn't we just read what Satan put in the heart of Judas Iscariot to betray Jesus? And then we just read, and at the beginning of the lesson, we read that David, when he wrote these songs, he said, the Lord put his word in my mouth, spoke for me through my mouth. Read that again, because this is talking about Judas Iscariot through the Spirit, through a psalm of David. You get there, brother.
Yeah, my own familiar friend, in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread, and lifted up his heel against me. But thou, Lord, be merciful unto me, and raise me up, that I may requite him. By this I know that thou favorest me, because my enemy doth not triumph over me. And as for me, thou upholdest me in mine integrity, and settest me before thy face forever. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting and to everlasting. Amen and amen.
Amen. Yeah. Now let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. And we're going to pick it up at verse 14. Because out of the Eden, God took away the tree of life. And when Jesus died on the cross, he came and gave us access back to the tree of life. Through the bindings of the Holy Bible, you know what I'm saying, the Word of God, from Genesis to Revelation, you get the law and the testimony. Okay? Now, I'm going to pick it up at Genesis 3 and 14, brother, when you get there, go ahead.
And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, above every beast in the field, of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life.
Now we see that he's not eating dust, actually eating dust, but he's walking to and fro. We read it. Go ahead.
And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
And we see that Satan bruised Jesus' heel, because he was in the grave 3 days and 3 nights. But Satan's head is going to be bruised, and he's going to be in the lake of fire forever. Go ahead.
Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband. He shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, curses the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. And the sweat of thy face shall thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shall thou return. And Adam called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. And to Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skin and clothe them. And the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turneth every way to keep the way of the tree of life.
Okay. So God took away access to the tree of life from Adam and Eve. But Jesus came and gave us access back again by dying, by coming, being sinless. Okay? Showing us how to do it, being sinless, and being baptized. And that's why we are baptized for the remission of sin. For the remission of sin, past sin. Okay? We don't want to sin presumptuous. You know what I'm saying? Willful. But if we sin, we want to sin inadvertently. And we don't even want to sin inadvertently by mistake. Okay? You know what I'm saying? But I'm just saying, if we do, it's by mistake. We're not doing it of our own will. Let's go to Exodus chapter 25. We've got about 6 or 7 more scriptures we've got. Exodus 25. Exodus 25, 17 through 22.
And thou shalt make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2 cubits and a half shall be the length thereof, and 1 cubit and a half the breadth thereof. And thou shalt make 2 cherubims of gold of beaten work, shall thou make them, in the 2 ends of the mercy seat. And make 1 cherub on the 1 end, and the other cherub on the other end. Even of the mercy seat shall ye make cherubims on the 2 ends thereof.
This represents the throne of God. Go ahead.
And the cherubims shall stretch forth their wings on high, covering the mercy seat with their wings, and their faces shall look one to another. Toward the mercy seat shall the faces of the cherubims be. And thou shalt put the mercy seat above upon the ark, and in the ark thou shalt put the testimony that I shall give thee.
So therefore, you're going to put the mercy seat above the ark, okay? The ark was posed in the 10 commandments, right? So you got to think about that. The mercy seat is actually sitting upon the 10 commandments. You know what I'm saying? That's something to think about. God, it says that his mercy endures forever. Okay? Mercy seat is sitting on top of the ark. And inside the ark is the 10 commandments. Go ahead.
And there I will meet with thee, and I will commune with thee from above the mercy seat, from between the 2 cherubims which are upon the ark of the testimony, of all things which I will give thee in commandment to the children of Israel.
Okay? Go from here to Psalms 80 and 1. Because this represents the throne of God. Psalms 80 and 1. Because remember I told you that God has cherubims around his throne? You read in the Old Testament, I think Ezekiel, the beginnings of Ezekiel, to find out about this cherub. Psalms 80, we're going to read verse 1, because we're going to see that this mercy seat sitting on top of the ark represents the throne of God, the cherubim. Around the throne of God. When you get there, brother, just read verse 1.
Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, thou that leadest Joseph like a flock, thou that dwellest between the cherubims, shine forth.
So God dwelleth in heavenly places, dwelleth between the cherubims. Like I said, you cannot sneak up on God with his cherubims around him. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, us down here on earth, we might be us a pit bull or something, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Or something like that, or rock baller, you know what I'm saying? But God got these cherubs. And this is amazing, but God is so awesome, you know. And it blows my mind. Every time I read this Bible, it blows my mind. It makes me want to worship him even more. Now let's go from here to Psalms chapter 99. Flip ahead to 99. Psalms chapter 99, read verses 1 through 9. Get there, Brother Barack, when everybody gets there. Psalms 99, verses 1 through 9. And we got about 4 or 5 out there. Go ahead, brother.
The Lord reigneth. Let the people tremble. He sendeth between the cherubims. Let the earth be moved. The Lord is great in Zion, and he is high above all the people. Let them praise thy great and terrible name, for it is holy. The king's strength also loveth judgment. Thou dost establish equity. Thou executest judgment and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt ye the Lord our God, and worship at his footstool, for he is holy. Moses and Aaron among his priests, and Samuel among them that call upon his name. They called upon the Lord, and he answered them. He spake unto them in the cloudy pillar. They kept his testimonies and the orders that he gave them. Thou answerest them, O Lord our God. Thou wast a God that forgavest them, though thou tookest vengeance of their inventions. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy hill. The Lord our God is holy.
Okay. And he is holy. Let's go from here to Ezekiel chapter 11. Pick it up at verse 22, we'll read verses 22 and 24. Ezekiel 11, 22 and 24. You get there, brother.
Then did the cherubims lift up their wings, and the wheels beside them. And the glory of the God of Israel was over them above. And the glory of the Lord went up from the midst of the city, and stood upon the mountain which is on the east side of the city. Afterwards the Spirit took me up, and brought me in a vision by the Spirit of God into Chaldea, to them of the captivity. So the vision that I had seen went up from me.
Okay, you know what? You know, I was thinking one day about, you know, how they have if you read about the cherubims, they have these wheels that follow them everywhere they go. You know what I'm saying? As they fly around the earth, you know, they report back to God what's happening in the earth. And I was looking at TV, and I was looking at a movie or something, and I was looking at, you know, and this is just my opinion of what I was thinking. You know how they say, they've been trying to figure out what those crop circles is in those cornfield, you know, the crop circles, you know what I'm saying? Those circles, they can't figure out what is making these crop circles. And the cherubims, and I was looking at that, so, now the way the Bible says those wheels, I was thinking, I say, it could be those cherub angels resting in those cornfields, you know, when they come down sometime when everybody's sleeping at night. Probably, that's just my opinion, but I'm just saying, they can't figure out, you know, it's just amazing to me. It just put it on my mind when I was thinking about it. I said, that could be what's making those crop circles. Wow. Because they cannot figure out how that's happening in those cornfields. You know what I'm saying? And the angels, you know, they could come down and they can reveal themselves if they want to, but they can be invisible too. You know what I'm saying? So this is something, you know, something to think about. Let's go. Did you finish that book?
Yeah.
Let's go from here to Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. Revelation 2 and 7. That's not in the Bible. That's just something I was experiencing. Something that's just a conclusion I was coming to. But they can't figure out how they're making them crop circles, and they can't figure out who's doing it and how they're doing it. I was reading about how God made the cherub angels, how they got these wheels that turn every which way. They can turn up like this, they can come flat. You know, and they go everywhere the cherub angels fly. And they go sideways, up and down, everywhere the cherubs go, the wheels go. You know what I'm saying? I was thinking about that. I was like, man, that's something to think about. Revelations chapter 2, one verse, brother, verse 7.
He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh, will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God.
So if you are become, you will have access to the tree of life, which is in the midst of paradise. Now let's go to chapter 22. Revelation 22. Pick it up at verse 7, and then we'll skip down and read 12 and 14. Revelation 22. Verse 7.
Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book.
Okay, skip down and read verses 12 to 14.
And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city.
Okay. So therefore, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have access to what? Tree of life. So you got these commandments. Keep coming back to these commandments. The tree of life and the word of God. Okay? Which is that manna, that living bread, that wine, that milk, that meat. You know what I'm saying? That water of life. It goes on and on and on. Did you read the 14 book?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's go from here. We got one more, two more. We got to go to Revelation chapter 11. Revelation is 11. We'll pick up at verse 15. We'll read verses 15 through 18. And we got one more after this. Revelation 11, 15 through 18. Can you get there, brother?
The seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fell upon their faces and worshiped God, saying, we give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and was and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast reigned. And the nations were angry, and thy wrath has come, in the time of the dead, that they should be judged, that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants, the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth.
Okay. And now we're going to look at the last scripture and verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Corinthians 15, I'll read verses 20 through 23. And then we'll read 50 through 53. 1 Corinthians 15. 23.
But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive.
Because see, when Adam died, he took away access to the tree of life, from Adam and Eve. And it says, since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, that's why we died today, because of Adam. Even so, in Christ shall all be made alive. God, Jesus came and gave us access back to the tree of life.
Amen.
And what is that access? Where is that tree of life? Right here. In the bindings of this book. The Holy Bible from Genesis to Revelation. All 66 chapters from Genesis to Revelation. Go ahead, bro.
But every man in his own order. Christ, the first fruits. Afterward, they that are Christ at his coming.
And then skip down to 50. Read 53.
Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality.
So go ahead and give it read it down to 56.
So when this corruptible shall be have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law.
It always comes back to the word of God. We have access back to the tree of life. Nobody dies anymore. Death is dead. And there you have it, tree of life. I hope you understood that lesson.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Chris, for that fine class through the Word of God.
Our Father, which art in heaven,
hallowed
be thy name.
Hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done in earth.
Thy will be done in earth.
As it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Forgive us our debts.
And forgive us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation.
And lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom.
For thine is the kingdom.
And the power.
And the power.
And the glory forever.
And the glory forever.
In Jesus' holy and blessed name we pray.
In Jesus' holy and blessed name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
In Jesus' holy name.
In Jesus' holy name.
Amen.
Amen. That's what I do.